Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this, once again tonight, is the Inside Corner. This is a familiar face, our topic, our subject, our guest. A familiar face. You may recognize this gentleman. His name is Kevin Guilfoile. He happens to be a resident of LaGrange. And he is a multifaceted individual who has always interested me because of the rather unusual combination of a high level of literacy, despite the fact that he worked in professional sports. Excuse my cynicism, but that is a contradiction or an irony, an oxymoron. High literacy in professional sports. Allow me that cynical remark. But Kevin's been on before, and there's so much that I did not extract from him that I thought having him on again would complete this, the biography. Tonight, the emphasis with Kevin, once we get his accomplishments out of the way, the emphasis tonight will be about his experiences as a teen, as a student at Cooperstown High School. Yes, the same one, Cooperstown, New York, the home of the Baseball Hall of Fame. You see, because Kevin's father, Bill, was the vice president of the Baseball Hall of Fame. His father had segued into that job after having had public relations directorships with two Major League Baseball clubs, the New York Yankees and the Pittsburgh Pirates. And so Kevin grew up in Cooperstown, New York, attended Cooperstown High School, and as a 14 and a 15 and a 16 and a 17, wait, 18, were you still in town?
Sure, yep.
18-year-old, like any teenager, he was mischievous. And those are the stories I like best about his dabbling in the archives at the Baseball Hall of Fame, you know, when Dad wasn't watching. He is here basically for that aspect of his biography, but we can't let him go without informing you that LaGrange has rather an accomplished author living here in town, and I want you to know about his works. Here is the first of his works, Cast of Shadows, a psychological thriller, published in 2004.
Five.
Mm-hmm. And available everywhere. Cast of Shadows, if you like psychological thrillers, even if you don't, this could be your introduction to such, to that genre, as they say. And then most recently, in 2010, mm-hmm. correct?
Yep.
The Thousand, Kevin Guilfoile. And then in 2012, a very quick read, makes a great Christmas gift to anyone. Really, it's an interesting little read. It's the story of?
It's about, first of all, my father's experiences yes. as in baseball, his 35-year yes. career as a baseball executive. It's about his struggle with dementia.
Yes.
And it's also a mystery about a bat that hung in my...
It belonged
to my father, hung in my bedroom as a child.
But it was Roberto Clemente's bat.
It was Roberto Clemente, and right around the time my father became ill, I came across a piece of paper that, if true, meant that this bat may have been the bat that Clemente used for his 3,000th final hit. Yeah.
And
so it's about my efforts to try to see if that could possibly be true.
I've read it. And I have bought many copies of it, and I have given them away as presents to friends and colleagues in professional baseball. A nice little read. I gave this book, Kevin, to Theo Epstein.
Oh.
Yes, I did. I gave it to Jason McLeod and Jed Hoyer, who are the executives right now in the hierarchy of the Chicago Cubs. They were very grateful for it.
I appreciate that.
I think I had you sign some. You
That's
remember?
Right.
Yes, I had you sign some. And those books went to Epstein, McLeod, and Hoyer with the Cubs.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, and other executives with the Boston Red Sox, because it's that kind of thing, you know. Yeah. Try this. A drive in the gap. And, okay, we'll get back to those later. But you have written a screenplay.
I have.
Yeah. Entitled Chasing the Blues.
Right.
And it grew from a short story that you wrote.
Right.
In 2012.
You know, I don't remember when it was published. It was in a collection called Chicago Blues.
Yes.
It was probably around 2010, 2009, 2010, I think.
And this has already been produced as a motion picture.
Right. It's in post-production now.
Yes. And the stars are John Lovitz.
They're not necessarily the main characters, but it features John Lovitz and Steve Guttenberg.
Okay. And it's going to make its travels through the circuit of film festivals.
Right. It's an indie
as
film.
As an independent
yep.
film.
Yeah, made by all Chicago crew, Chicago director.
Really?
Yep. Produced locally. Okay. Filmed here in Chicago.
Filmed here in Chicago.
Yep.
In which locations? Cine Studios down there?
Mostly on locations.
Really?
There was an apartment in Hyde Park. There was a storage facility in, I think it was in Willowbrook.
Yes.
All over Chicago. There was some scenes shot on a bus. It was a long section that takes place.
Chasing the Blues. Give me the plot, synopsis.
It's about a pair of vinyl record collectors in the 80s, right around the time CDs are coming into fashion and people are throwing out their old records. And these guys discover a mythical blues record, so rare it was thought not to actually exist.
By iconic blues musicians?
Well, by a fictional iconic, the only record the guy ever made.
All right.
And
somebody like a Muddy Waters?
Like a Robert Johnson,
okay.
maybe. And it was, this record is rumored to have the screams of a woman being murdered on it.
Interesting.
And these rival collectors discover this record in a woman's apartment on the South Side. And they refuse to leave the apartment because they know the other one will just steal it.
Mm-hmm.
And they can't fall asleep.
Yes.
And it's treasure of Sierra
yeah.
Madre, basically,
yeah.
with a blues record in a Chicago apartment. So part of it takes place in the 80s. That's when the short story took place, in the 80s in this apartment. And then part of it takes place 20 years later when these guys get out of prison for what happened in that apartment, and they're still both obsessed with this record.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited.
Clever. Looking forward to seeing this. Is it available in written form? The short story?
The short story
again
was,
is in an anthology.
It was in an anthology called Chicago Blues, which is a you
Chicago
should find
Blues.
That.
I'm writing that down for my own sake. Mm-hmm. Chicago Blues short story anthology by Kevin.
The short story was called "Oh Death, Where Is Thy Sting?"
Oh Death, Where Is Thy Sting? All right. Okay, that's for my sake. All right. Okay, going backwards. I'm good at that. Graduate of Cooperstown High School, Notre Dame University in 1990 with a degree in journalism. Stayed there at Notre Dame as the baseball, soccer, and hockey sports information director. Moved on in 1991 to Sports Channel back here in Chicago in advertising and public relations. 1992, worked in the media relations department of the Houston Astros National League Professional Baseball Club. 1993, back to Chicago, where he was creative director for Kudal Advertising and Design. 2004, began to write. 2017, May 24th, 5th, what is today? He's here with us. And he's here with us because he has the most romantic, rich, memoirs of having lived in Cooperstown, New York, where his father was the vice president of the Baseball Hall of Fame, and he got to have his free reign of the building once in a while. Is that not true? Didn't you do some naughty things?
No.
Come
I was
on.
Good. I was good in the hall.
Huh?
But
you were good?
I never touched anything I wasn't supposed to touch.
Okay. That's what you said. That's what you say now. You wouldn't be here on the show if you hadn't told me some things. Look, here is the baseball field. This is a very good landscape photograph of Cooperstown itself. What river would that be?
Well, that's Lake Otsego.
Oh, okay.
But the mouth of the Susquehanna is right there at the corner of the lake.
Quaint little place.
It's beautiful, yeah.
Quaint. Idyllic. town. Of course, once again, home to the Baseball Hall of Fame. And here is the Ebner Doubleday baseball field in Cooperstown. It's packed with people now. Was this a Hall of Fame game with major league teams?
I believe that was a Hall of Fame game.
Yes. But you see, as a student of Cooperstown High School and a member of the varsity baseball team at Cooperstown, this is where Kevin Guilfoile played his high school baseball games.
You know, the stands weren't always quite so packed.
No, there maybe were 30 people.
Maybe.
But look at what quaintness. What quaintness. Okay. From whence did you move? From where did you live before Cooperstown?
Well, I was born in New Jersey when my father worked for the Yankees.
Yeah.
But when I was very young, we moved to Pittsburgh. And he was the PR director of the Pirates, all through the 70s.
How old were you then?
Oh, I was maybe two when we moved there. And then when I was in fifth grade, we moved to Cooperstown.
In fifth grade?
Right. So I really consider Cooperstown is really where I grew up.
Now see, no one understands. People live in Cooperstown.
It's funny you say that. When I was working for the Astros, when I first went to work there, I was in the press box and I was meeting the writers and the sports writers. And one of them asked me where I was from, and I said I was from Cooperstown. And he was stunned. Yeah. He thought about it for a long time. He said, I have been there I don't know how many times. I've covered baseball I don't know how many years. Yeah. He said, it is only just now occurring to me that people live there.
Yeah.
It was as if I had said I lived in Epcot.
Yes.
Like it didn't make, you know, it was like just this mythical place that, you know, where that existed only for baseball.
I'm sure people from Key Largo get the same, or people from Las Vegas get the same reaction. You live in Las Vegas,
But Cooperstown is really an old town that was actually famous even before the Hall of Fame came. It was founded by the father of James Fenimore Cooper, who was the first famous novelist in the United States, sort of the James Patterson of the mid-1800s, probably. And so because of his notoriety, it became... and because it's so beautiful it became a vacation spot, kind of a resort community for wealthy people in the Northeast.
Okay.
Did
these people come out of New York City?
Primarily, I would say. Yeah.
So they had their second home or summer place, a retreat.
A lot of them, yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
In that area.
Right. So Cooperstown itself is populated with lots of Victorian mansions. Mm-hmm. I mean, the houses there are beautiful and large.
Large.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a gorgeous, gorgeous town.
Okay, so what was your house like?
We had a little Cape Cod right in town. We were right across the street from the big resort hotel in town, which is the Otisaga, and right across the street from the lake. But that was plenty of house for...
Would you go back there?
Would I move back?
Would you go back there? Yes.
I think so. I mean, it was a wonderful place to be a teenager. Mm. It was safe. The schools were fantastic. There was plenty to do. It was absolutely one of the most beautiful places I've ever
been. Once you got to high school age, did you have part-time employment? Were you working?
I did. I always worked. I was a stock boy at a place called the Farm and Home Bargain Center, which is basically a Ben Franklin store. And then after I went, so I did that through junior high and high school. And then after I went away to college, when I would come back for summers, I was, I think my title was houseboy for a man named Stephen Clark, who was one of the wealthiest men in the town. In fact, his family were sort of longtime patrons of Cooperstown. They are, his family has very significant figures in the history of Cooperstown and the Baseball Hall of Fame.
How did he make his money?
So his grandfather moved to Cooperstown. They had homes all over the East Coast, but he built a summer home in Cooperstown. His grandfather was named Edward Clark, and he was a New York attorney who, and his law firm represented, I'm forgetting his first name, but the founder of Singer Sewing Machine. Singer. Mm-hmm. And so he made much of his fortune, I believe, just as along with Singer. As that company grew, so did his law firm. And he took great interest in Cooperstown and bought a tremendous amount of land there.
Yes.
Built the Otisauga Hotel, built the big resort hotel,
yes,
the golf course. And then at some point during the 30s and even before that, he would have people were out of work. He would just put them to work building structures around town and around mm-hmm. the lake, just mm-hmm. so mm-hmm. that people would have something to do and they could earn a living. And
yeah.
In fact, the front of that book that you're holding right there, that's one example. It's a tower on the lake. It really doesn't serve any purpose. It's beautiful. It looks it's a great landmark on the water. But I believe he had it built just.
Leading to tell me. You're working in your way to tell me. Is this the fella that builds the Baseball Hall of Fame?
Right. So his son, Steven Sr.
His son,
Steven, was living in Cooperstown. Now, well, of course, while this in the early, I think you sort of have to go back in history and talk about the history of the Mills Commission. So around the turn of the century, there was a big debate among baseball fans about whether baseball was an American game,
yes,
or whether it had evolved from rounders,
British
an English
rounders,
game.
Yes.
And there was a great amount of patriotic fervor. There was a large movement of people who really wanted the answer to be that it was an American game. It was invented in America. So a commission was set up by, I believe, his former National League president was the head of it. And it was sort of a rigged game. They basically set up a commission to determine where in America baseball was invented. Begging the question of whether
right,
it had been
yeah,
or not.
Right.
And so they just sent out word, anybody who has information about where baseball was invented,
yes,
let us know. And they heard from a mining engineer in Denver, Colorado, a guy named Abner Graves. This guy was in his 70s by this time. This was in the early 1900s. And he claimed that he was in Cooperstown, he grew up in Cooperstown,
yes,
actually in Fly Creek, right outside,
yes,
of Cooperstown. And he claimed that he was there when Abner Doubleday, who would have been very famous, Abner Doubleday was a famous
Civil War
general.
Yeah, general.
But Abner Doubleday went to military school in Cooperstown.
Yeah.
So he claims that while Abner Doubleday was a student at this military academy, he invented baseball.
He witnessed this.
And Abner Graves claims he was there when Abner Doubleday sketched
out. Hold this mystery.
The
baseball invented in Cooperstown. Was it or was it just public relations? We'll find out. We have to take a public service announcement break. We won't be far away. Please don't go away. You're watching LTTV. My name is Terry Sullivan. This is The Inside Corner. Our guest is author and former Cooperstown, New York resident, LaGrange resident, Kevin Guilfoile. Don't go away. We'll be right here waiting for you. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is The Inside Corner. And tonight we are more or less reminiscing with LaGrange resident and author Kevin Guilfoile about his days as a teenage boy going to Cooperstown, New York High School. Yes, Cooperstown, the same one, the home of the Baseball Hall of Fame, where his father was the vice president of the Baseball Hall of Fame. But, you know, LaGrange needs to be proud of this gentleman. He is an accomplished author in the psychological thriller genre. His first book, A Cast of Shadows, followed by The Thousand, in between, in a whole altogether another category. It would be memoir.
Yeah.
It would be memoir.
Yep.
Basically, this is the story of his dad, William. And a very complicated, intricate attempt to prove that a certain bat, the Holy Grail, a Holy Grail in sports memorabilia, the bat with which Roberto Clemente hit his 3,000th major league hit, the authentication of that bat is really the subplot,
mm-hmm,
of a drive into the gap. Brief read, look at that. Look at that. You can do that in a day. Come on, and it's really entertaining.
There's a Frank Sinatra story in there. There's a Marilyn Monroe story,
yes,
in there.
You see, because
it's not just baseball.
Yes, this is a sideline now. You see, in Cooperstown is where baseball players come in July. I believe it's July every year, to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And there are other dignitaries and celebrities who show up. Baseball, like Frank Sinatra was a great baseball fan. And Joe DiMaggio was married to Marilyn Monroe. You know her? Yes. And get this now. Tell me if I have this correct.
Sure.
Marilyn Monroe and Joe DiMaggio had dinner in your house.
Before I was there, but yes.
Before you were born?
Yeah.
Before,
oh, yeah. No. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Before you were born.
Oh, yeah.
They had dinner in your home in Cooperstown.
Right, when somebody else was living there.
Right. And she actually washed the dishes after dinner as a gratuity, as a sign of gratefulness for her dinner.
That is the story.
Marilyn Monroe washed dishes at the kitchen sink in Kevin Guilfoile's house in Cooperstown, New York. Now, come on. You know, that's really insane. That's it. So, now, to further authenticate the literacy of Kevin Guilfoile, he has written a screenplay. A screenplay that is based on a short story of his called Chasing the Blue.
Mm-hmm. Chasing the Blues.
Chasing the Blues. A short story that comes from an anthology of his called Chicago Blues.
Yeah, I just have one story out
of it. One story in the anthology. Mm-hmm. And it is a produced motion picture, and it is making its way now, independent film, making its way through film festivals. It stars John Lovitz and Steve Guttenberg. Steve Guttenberg.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully you'll get to see that on Netflix or Amazon.com or at the Music Box Theater on Southport Avenue. It's that type of film I get feeling.
Yep. Yeah.
But nonetheless, we're here to talk about Kevin's experiences as a youngster in Cooperstown, New York, his father being the vice president of the Baseball Hall of Fame. Do you believe it? You were telling us about the owner.
Right.
The owner, originator, founder of the Baseball Hall of Fame, because most people out there don't realize that the Baseball Hall of Fame is a privately owned enterprise.
Correct.
It is not owned by Major League Baseball.
Nope.
Okay,
nope.
Go ahead.
So this commission decided baseball was invented in Cooperstown based on the say-so of this one person.
Who claimed to have witnessed Abner Doubleday originate the sport.
They did no further investigation. In fact, if they had done any investigation, they would have realized that in 1839, when this event allegedly happened, Abner Doubleday wasn't even in Cooperstown. He was already at West Point.
Okay, yeah.
So no part of this story makes any sense. Also, Abner Doubleday, who was a very famous person who had journals and memoirs, never mentioned baseball in his entire life.
False.
But they said, case closed, baseball invented in Cooperstown.
Good Chamber of Commerce.
All right. Yeah. So in the 1930s, this house that once belonged to this man, Abner Graves, who is now long since dead, was sold, and somebody found an old baseball in the attic. And so to a lot of people, to people who wanted to believe this story, they thought this was the proof at last.
Yeah,
so, right. This thing became known as the Abner Doubleday Baseball, even though it was found in the house of a man named Abner Graves.
Yeah.
Stephen Clark Sr., who was a wealthy resident of Cooperstown, he bought this ball for $5 and kept it as a curiosity in his office. And so many people wanted to come see it that he had the idea to build a museum.
Build it and they will come.
Right. And so this would have been 1935. The centennial of baseball was coming in 1939. I think he had the wherewithal to say, we could maybe make something out of this. And so then that was the seeds of the Baseball Hall of Fame, and they and ended up opening the museum on the Centennial Baseball in 1939.
He must have had an intense search for subject matter to put into the museum. He had to be searching everywhere and spending money like wildfire.
Yeah, although, you know, back then, even until very recently, baseball memorabilia was not really considered all that valuable. Do you know what I mean? I mean, people didn't collect it prior to, like, the 1970s, probably, or the 1980s.
Yeah,
even.
Then there was that surge, yes.
Right. So I don't exactly know what his hunt for memorabilia was like, but I imagine it was a lot easier, certainly, than it would be now. Yeah. And so they opened the museum in 1939, and over the course, rest of the century, they kept expanding it and expanding, kept getting larger and larger and more popular.
Okay, now, how did your dad get to be director? He was a public relations executive, mm-hmm. with the Yankees.
Right.
And he segued. How did he get the job? Why did he leave?
Prior to him, most of the employees of the Hall of Fame were people who grew up in Cooperstown. They were not necessarily baseball people. And the person who was the public relations director prior to my father getting there was actually a longtime sports writer named Ken Smith, a New York sports writer.
Yes.
But other than that, they didn't have too many people there with strong connections to baseball. And so I think the idea of when Kenny retired, the idea was to bring in my father, who had connections to baseball players, to the ball clubs.
Yes.
And specifically what I think that they were interested in having him do was to attract more Hall of Famers to come back mm-hmm. for the induction ceremonies. Mm-hmm. At the time, I think a lot of baseball players looked at it as it was just sort of a mob scene. It was a difficult weekend.
A pain for them.
It was kind of a bright. It wasn't fun. I don't think it was fun for them.
Yeah.
And so my father, made sure, sort of up the security and provide activities, a golf tournament and some other things that might attract them.
Yes.
And then he begged and pleaded and did
so
all of those things as well.
He grew the ceremony, your dad, in his
era.
Yeah,
I think so. Yeah. I think you could say that.
All right.
It worked. And after, throughout the 80s and into the 90s and up until today, I think that it's something that a lot of these guys really enjoy and look forward to.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
It's died and gone to heaven for them.
Yeah.
Okay, so you must have met a whole lot of Hall of Fame players.
Yeah.
A whole lot of them.
Yeah.
Did you ever meet Mantle or Maris?
Mantle was a good friend of my father's from his time that my dad worked for the Yankees in the 60s.
Yes.
I only met him once. He came to Cooperstown. As far as I know, Mantle only came to Cooperstown once to film a show for NBC that was going to run, I think, the night before the All-Star game, sometime in the 80s. I want to say 84. It starred Billy Crystal was the host of it.
Yeah,
Mantle filmed a whole bunch of bits with Billy Crystal at the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, Crystal.
So that is the only time I ever met him was the couple days that he was filming at the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, Crystal's a rabid Yankees fan and a Mantle admirer. So you named some that you've met.
When Ted Williams finally came, he didn't realize that the hotel they were staying at, there's one big resort hotel in Cooperstown, it's a beautiful hotel. And at the time, you needed to wear a jacket in the hotel after 5 o'clock, and Ted Williams never wore a sport coat. So he realized he couldn't get back into the hotel on a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
So we lived across the house. He came over and knocked on our door with his son, John Henry, and said, "Bill, I can't get into the hotel. They won't let me in without a jacket." So our next door neighbor owned a clothing store in town, but fortunately.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we called him up. He went in and opened up his store called the Village Squire, it was called, and brought a bunch of the largest coats, sport jackets that he had.
Oh, my God. For sure.
Outfitted Ted Williams and his son in our living room so he could get back into his hotel and go to dinner.
Now, what about the iconic old-timers?
I had one time...
Like Hornsby ever show up there? Or?
Boy, I think
he
was not still around, I think, by the time we were there.
Who else?
Wade Hoyt once had dinner at my house.
Yes.
So Wade Hoyt, who was played with Babe Ruth, was a pitcher, played with Babe Ruth in the...
Yes.
He actually, I believe he pitched his first game when he was 16, I think, for the Yankees.
My God.
So he was like a teenage baseball idol.
Yeah.
He's the Justin Bieber of baseball in the 1930s. And it happened that weekend when he was there, my grandfather was visiting, my mother's father.
Yeah.
And he grew up in Brooklyn. And he actually remembered that one day when Wade Hoyt was still in high school, he took my grandfather's next door neighbor to the prom. And so he had pulled up, Wade Hoyt, who was a huge celebrity in New York, pulled up in this big car and came out that's one of my fondest memories of childhood is my grandfather telling the story and Wade Hoyt was so excited. Yeah. He remembered, every bit of it remembered this girl and they talked all night about Brooklyn.
You have so many of these things you could, I don't know what the thread would be to tie them together, but you could go on and on about this. The things you saw and the iconic baseball characters.
Yeah.
Did you not tell me? Did I make this up in my mind out of such high interest in your background there? did you not tell me that you cavorted in the archives, that you sneaked into the archives?
No, I don't think that's true.
You didn't tell me
that? No. I'd been down there. I went down there with my father,
yes.
But I never snuck in there.
For what reasons would you go down in there?
Oh, just to.
And they are in the basement around of the Hall of Fame, the archives.
At the time, I don't know. I haven't been there in many years, so yeah. I don't know where they
okay,
are.
Okay, you know,
archives. There were some.
There's more in the archives of any museum than there is on display.
Right.
Okay, Babe Ruth's uniform.
Oh, yeah, they have multiple.
Didn't you tell me some story about... Did you ever try on Babe Ruth's uniform?
I did not. No, that's a great... That would be a good story.
I have... What have I done to you? I don't know. I told people that
there
you
There is
tried
a story.
Well, okay. What is it?
No. I'm trying to think what it could have been that you might have confused. There is... going back to the time Mail came to visit, one of the things they figured out then was they had a locker, Babe Ruth's locker,
yes,
on display in the,
yes,
Hall of Fame with his uniform in it.
Yes.
And Mantle was going around with Billy Crystal and my dad. It was just after the museum was closed,
yes,
and they were just going around touring the museum. And Mantle said, this was my locker too. Which,
really?
Which nobody knew.
Really?
That Pete Sheehy, the clubhouse manager of the Yankees, gave him Babe,
yeah,
Ruth's locker. So they didn't even know they had, they knew they had a Babe Ruth locker. They didn't know,
yeah,
they had a Mickey Mantle locker, too.
Yeah. Wow. So, okay. Your dad had keys to those archives?
I suppose he did.
And you were never tempted to take those keys and go down in there and touch things and look at things?
No, you know.
Oh, gosh. I mean, I would have been the worst adolescent son.
I mean, part of it was I just grew up. I grew up around baseball players. I grew,
yeah,
up, before coming,
yeah,
to Cooperstown, I spent my entire summer at Three River Stadium. I was around ball players a lot. I was
a
in
lot,
clubhouses,
yeah,
a lot. I was around baseball stuff a lot.
A lot.
I manage a little league team.
Right.
And when we have practices, I have a home plate in my trunk,
yes,
that came from Three River Stadium.
Really?
That I use for practice,
yes,
that I lug around to the fields when I,
yes,
can't get into the.
And you
thing.
Were there
so
when
I had,
Barry,
like,
you were there
I
when Barry Bonds was a young player.
I was interning for the Pirates in '89,
yes,
when he was a skinny leadoff
hitter. Right, yeah. And then he got big all,
yeah,
of a sudden.
Yeah. Mysteriously,
and he
mysteriously got big. Who can possibly explain how that?
Yeah,
happened?
How could that happen?
But
Kevin, so exciting. You know, that's why I like to have people like you. There was one other person with the contradictory, juxtaposed life of experiences that I find so enthralling, and her name was Lisa Menninger, and she was a flat-out great jazz singer who had discs out, you know, mm-hmm, her own albums, and she was a personal trainer, and she was a nutritionist. And I said, how could you be those things? And that's how I feel about you. How could you have worked in professional baseball, been around all of that, been a child with your dad directing the Cooperstown Hall of Fame, and then have written books like this, these psychological thrillers, which are, this is a realm away from what your training was as a kid.
Yeah, but you know, I think that people tell you that you should write what you know, but I think that it is much more interesting to write what you're curious about.
Yeah.
You know, and baseball, it was a world that I was very familiar with, and it,
yes,
was more interesting to me to write about things I was less familiar with.
Okay, all that glitters is not gold, right? And so people think, oh my God, you had this childhood with all the players around you and all that. But did it wear off the patina, and did you see behind the scenes stuff that made you think?
Not so much in Cooperstown.
No. Not in Cooperstown, but in,
yeah,
when you were working for the Astros, when you were hanging with your dad around the Pirates and the and,
yeah,
all of that, did it wear off? Did some of the sheen wear off of this? Did some of it, the behind,
well,
the facade,
I mean,
behind the glamorous facade?
I had some run-ins. You mentioned Barry Bonds.
Yeah.
I had some difficulty with,
yes,
him.
Yes.
You know, and part of that was my, you know, I was very young too, so he was an extremely difficult person, and I didn't have a lot of experience,
yeah,
in dealing with that kind of personality.
Like that. Yeah.
And so I spent an entire summer really butting heads with him almost every day.
Because you were representing him to the media.
Well, no, the reason that I came in conflict with him was I wasn't even doing anything that important. I was like the lowest guy in the totem pole.
Yeah.
And so the community relations department would send me every day in the clubhouse to get autographs for sick kids in hospitals or the owner of the team needed something for somebody, whatever it was. And so I would have a list every day of autographs that they needed. And most of those kids, most of those guys were perfectly happy to spend 30 seconds in the side of the nut berry. No. And so, it was my job, but I couldn't not come back with them.
Yeah.
And it was my job to get these. Somebody was counting on this, and so it was a constant. I basically would stalk him. I would spend a good part of my day following.
You wanted to begging him.
It was, you know. So that was that part of baseball was less than glamorous, I will say.
Well. It's good to have you in LaGrange. Yeah, it's good. You raised the literacy quotient. It's good to have you, the work you've done, and we're anxious to see the motion picture, Chasing the Blues, independent film, John Lovitz and Steve Guttenberg, coming out somewhere soon, as soon as the circuit of film festivals is complete. Well, thanks, Kim.
Oh, thank you.
Appreciate it. No end. Yeah, very interesting. I want to thank Tony Klesinski on camera, Kevin Skonig and Matt O'Malley on camera, my director, David Carafa, and, of course, the cable station supervisor, Bill Allen, out in the truck. Thank you, Bill. This is The Inside Corner. My name is Terry Sullivan. Please come back again, and I'll be right home, Dolly, I promise.